On the agenda tonight, we're going back to just last month to take a look at The Warning performing Choke. Hello, Phil here from Wings of Pegasus, and welcome to another analysis video. If you enjoy this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe. So, it was only on Sunday that we were looking at June and Jean Millington from the band Fanny back in 1971, and they were sisters, of course, and now we have these three sisters bang up to date, The Warning, and they are friends of the channel. I did an interview with them here maybe a year or a little bit longer than that. I can't remember exactly how long it was, but that video will still be on the channel if you want to check that out independently. So we're going to be jumping into this live session performance, and then we'll be breaking things down. There's a lot to get into here. So what I'm going to do is let the video play the whole way through, and we can check out the performance from beginning to end, and then we will jump into the analysis afterwards. I won't say
survive the fall.
And there we have it. So, what a great performance that was. And What I love about the way that the Warning approach writing songs is that they make a focal point of the chorus, because sometimes when you're listening to a song and it sounds like it's not really going anywhere, or you're not sure whether you've heard the chorus yet or not. But what the ladies do so well here is make a journey out of the song, because we have a clean intro with an understated vocal. We then get into a riff. Everybody knows on this channel that I am a big fan of a heavy riff and some chunky guitars, and we certainly have that in this performance and the song as a whole. But then as we progress, we get into a pre-chorus, and then we've got a definite chorus in there, which includes the tagline of the song and the title of the song. We then have a verse, which is a little bit of a breakdown, and we have some clean guitar in there. We have a little bit of chunky guitar, but it's just single strums. So things are really taking a backseat dynamically, and it's great to have that journey, because then we can build back up into that pre-chorus and then into the chorus. We then have a middle eight, or a bridge as it's also called, which is just a different sight to see on the journey and breaks up the song. So you're hearing something totally different, totally new, before then getting into the chorus to the end. So we've got that definite layout of having a composition that is interesting the whole way through. So we've got all of that going on, but we've got, of course, harmony vocals in there. We've got heavy riffs, great rhythm guitar, and you've got Powell just going for it on the drum kit with some really cool fills, but also some syncopation in there, which is great as well to hear the way that that's thrown in to really mix it up a bit. And I love the way that Powell spends a little bit of time on those toms, generally during a build-up or a pre-chorus, to just add a little bit more drama, and it leads you into the chorus. You know that something's about to happen because of that floor tom that Powell leans into just in the pre-chorus. But what we're going to do is we'll bust out the guitar and we'll have a little look at what's going on here, but also I'll get into a little bit of detail and show examples of what I'm talking about. Okay, so jumping into the intro that we have, we've got, oh, by the way, we are detuned here. So if you are wanting to play along with this, you'll need to take your guitar down half a step or a semitone, and it means that all your strings are just going one note lower. So my guitar was originally in standard tuning, and it means that the strings are going to start to creep up, probably go a little bit sharp, but we'll just have to deal with that. We'll bust our way through it. So we're starting with, I'm going to be referring to these chords as the chord positions on the fretboard, rather than calling this a G, because that's what it would be because of the tuning on the guitar being down half a step, but I'm going to keep it and just call it as an A flat. So we are just using an A5 here, really, or an A-flat 5, because we've got the first finger on our root note, and we're just playing a power chord, so it means our third finger is going to be on the fifth. Can use a little finger there if you want to. So just jumping into the chords very quickly, we've got this really understated start to the song, and we're starting on our A-flat, and then we're just playing the fifth, so it's like a power chord here, just two strings. One, two, three, four, into the E-flat, and this is just for one bar, because we then go down to the G-flat, back to the A-flat, up to the E, two, three, four, and down to the E-flat. We have a little hold here, because we're then about to get into the riff, but let me just play the video so you guys have a reference point as to what we've just played through. Okay, so we have the riff, and then we're pretty much straight into this pre-chorus. So there's no time to breathe at any point during the verse, well, the start of the song, that quiet intro into the riff, now into the pre-chorus. So we haven't even had a verse, so there is no space to breathe, and that's very apt with the fact that it's called choke. So when we're getting into the riff, we have this And the technique here that Dani is applying on that right hand, just see how she's almost playing rhythm with that right hand. It looks like she's holding down chords. Well, obviously it doesn't look like that with the left hand, but if you were to watch the right hand, you'd assume that she was holding down chords because of the way that she's implementing that right hand to get the aggression in the sound. So when we've got this, that aggression on the strings, obviously that's part of the riff, the sound, the emotion, the expression of what she's playing. She wants to have that aggression in there. If you were playing through the riff and you went, then, I mean, that's fine, but you don't get the same aggression as if you do hit all those strings. And that's what will happen if you don't mute it. You have your strings that ring out underneath. Whereas when you're muting it, can hear, or hopefully you can hear, the slap of the strings. It's a little bit more percussive. And we also have little wobbles of vibrato in there. So I'll do that again. Those little pinches of vibrato which just give it a little bit more personality in the riff. So then as we get into this pre-chorus, it means that we're going into what would be our E down at the bottom with the tunings to E flat, but we'll call it an E. And again, it's going to be an E5, so more of a power chord sound here, and we're just chugging these along. G flat, A flat, G flat, and then back down again like that. So let me just play the video so we get a little bit of a reference point. And then we open up a little bit more now with the rhythm, once we've worked our way down. You know, we're now applying a little bit more on that right hand. And this is where we've got the syncopation coming in from Powell on drums. And this just adds a slightly different feel and personality to the pre-chorus, because now the pre-chorus is separated into two halves rather than just being the same the whole way through. And when I'm talking about syncopation, I have mentioned it in lots of other videos, but just quickly, if you imagine here, we are in 4-4, the time signature that this song is composed in, has been written in. So it means we're going 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. Those are our beats of the bar. And the beat that we've got going on here from Powell, we're going da, 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 da. So you can hear how it's coming in between the beats. We're not going da, 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 you know, and going with the beats of the bar. It's that da, 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 which is going to give it a totally different feel. And again, it's just going to make it interesting. It's something slightly different. And because there's so much changing, you're just being hit with a lot of musical information at once. So this is why when you're listening to it, you're never going to get bored, because there's always something different kicking off. And it means that you can then listen to the song again and start to appreciate these little details that have been thrown in there. But let's jump back into the video. Okay, so now we're into our chorus, just covering that pre-chorus. We did have some extra chords in there, let me just take it back. So we went into a D flat there, so we went the and then we're jumping up to the octave of the E where we started down at the bottom. So just sticking that together. Flat. Then holding up on the E, I mean, a little let that low E string ring out if you wanted to. So now we've got our A flat into the E into the G flat. So it's kind of like that. And that's going to be the chords for the first part of the chorus. Exactly the same thing there. Okay, slight change there. So we had our... went up to the E, went over to the B now. And it might be the fact that Dani, when she's played through that, she, I think, went from the A flat into the E and went down to the B here, before then going to the G flat there. But you... it doesn't really matter where you play that chord. Let's just have another little listen. Okay, same thing. So, listening out for the drums here. I mean, it is a major part of the sound, because when we're playing through the riff and, you know, here the... we want to be heavy there, and we are, because Powell is totally opening up that hi-hat, so it's going to have a lot more aggression in there. And listen to the transition into the verse, where now we're just into that closed hi-hat sound, really taking the foot off the accelerator from that dynamic perspective. I'm just going to rewind it, because we have a little bit of clean guitar in there as well, I believe. Yeah, it is difficult to make out whether that's a guitar or maybe a little bit of keys in there, but we have one guitar, which, you know, it's going to be a little bit cleaner, so I'll roll off a bit of volume. It's kind of chugs like that. And it sounds like we have this kind of thing going on in the background. And then down. So really subtle. This is another thing, just from a performance perspective, that I really like about the girls and how they approach live performance and keeping things in there from the record that can be, because of technology nowadays, you can keep things in from your album. Say, for example, there's a little bit of guitar or a little bit of keys in there in the background that you want to have live. You still can have that, even if you are a three-piece. And it just really adds that extra dimension to live performances, and it certainly does here as well. Just while I'm talking about the mix and the sound, I also love the way that the guitars are panned left and right here, so you get a really thick sound with the guitar. And these extra little elements that are in there, vocally, of course, we've got great vocals the whole way through from Dani and Pau, and then Ali gets involved towards the end in a really understated breakdown that we have later on in the song. But there is a really subtle lower octave, and vocally here, I mean, we're going all the way up to that E flat, and that's going to be an E flat 5, and that's what Danny's hitting as the high note in the chorus. But you've got that octave below that Powell is probably singing, so you get a really thick, it is really subtle, but you get a really thick vocal sound because of adding those octaves together. Also, the way that, I mean, in the chorus, we do actually have some octaves going on, or maybe it could just be one note on the guitar being held and then just picked or alternate picked, but we still get that sound of, when we do get into that chorus, just to quickly play through those chords, we've got that kind of approach, and it's going to be even up to, that kind of approach. So lots of strumming in there, but it's just filling in the sound. Like I said, it is subtle, but it's just in the background. And they really know how to layer things up and get things put in the right place in order to get the thickest sound live and not have to compromise on live because they are a three-piece. They really do make the most of everything that is available to them. But then we have up into an... Okay, we did have a little lead line there from Danny as well while the chords are being played in the background. So we had this and just single notes here. And because of those lead notes, it almost sounds like when we get into that D flat minor, when we get over to the E, we're just going down one, but it almost sounds like you could stick a seventh in there, an E flat seventh, because of those notes that we have. So, again, a really nice flavor to that sound. Let's get back into it. And now we're into this pre-chorus and the... You might be able to hear, I don't know whether you will be able to on your phones and your tablets or whatever you're watching it on, but I've got monitor speakers here, so it means that I can hear all of the elements really clearly, which is great, because you can hear the other guitar just playing those single lead notes at the same time as the... Those chugs, obviously, open up the volume. So it's just getting those layers together that are really cool. Okay, so now we're into this bridge, and again, we're on that G flat, into the A flat, into a B, I believe. And then we're back into G flat again. And then back up to the E, and then we just hold on that. And this is the breakdown again, dynamically. They have that appreciation of bringing everything down before then the big chorus, where we'll then open up the taps on everything again. But just allowing Ali to now sing the lead vocal, and again, it's that octave below, so it's going to be really understated. So just a quick word as well on the rhythm section, which is Ali and Pal being tight, being in the pocket, and just laying that foundation of the track. When you start to think about the other elements that are in there, I did mention on a video that I did on The Warning quite a while ago about how everything is so dependent on timing, tempo, and power, keeping everything together, especially if you are either triggering sounds or playing to a track that has different elements in it, so that power would be playing to a click track, and then you get those different elements that are kicking off, and power has to be absolutely on the ball throughout the whole live performance, because if the tempo goes off, if it's too fast by a beat, just one beat, per minute, then it's going to throw it all out for the whole song. All of those other elements that are kept in there. Like I said, I think that's a really cool thing to do, but you have to be so solid rhythmically in order to be able to pull that off live. And this is why the girls are so good, because they are one cohesive unit. When you're talking about the vocals, the harmonies, and just to talk about the melody in this song, because it is catchy. They have approached it, like I said, making a focal point of that chorus, but also having their high note in the chorus. So we get that nice gradual increase in pitch and increase in range from Danny. When we get up to that E flat 5 up at the top, it's that gradual increase in pitch that takes you on a journey. And that's exactly what it's like, just climbing up a mountain, climbing up stairs to hit that peak and to hit the crescendo of the song. So that's exactly what we have here. It's taking stuff out to make it interesting and not just go hell for leather the whole time. I mean, you might have a song where you do that and that's the point of the song, but it's great to make a journey out of the song, as the girls have done here. So compositionally, it's great stuff, because there's so much that you can listen to melodically, but then also analytically, when you dive into it, there's a lot going on here. Just something to mention finally, I know that some people might mention this in the comments section, that there is a little mistake in the editing where it looks like Danny isn't singing, and then she goes back to the mic and the voice continues. And this is going to be a case of, when you're recording a video, such as the ladies are here, generally you'll record your audio, and that'll be the audio that you then hear for the performance. But then you go through two or even three other takes in order to get all of the shots. And this is actually something that the Beatles did on their rooftop performance. They did every song either two or three times so that they'd perform it and you would have the audio, and then they'd record other angles just to make the video a little bit better looking. But also, that's why when you do watch that performance, some of the things don't sync up with what you're watching, but you can hear a different thing going on with the guitar, but you can't see it. Anyway, that's why that happens. So getting back to this, it means that you're doing two or three takes for the visual side of things. And say, for example, you want to have a close-up of Danny in the performance, it means that a camera would come in, and especially if you want a little bit of motion on the capture, on the captured video, but you want to have the motion captured in the shot, so it's moving, because it gives it a little bit more energy. So it would mean that if you got that close-up of Danny, and then we cut to this, as you can see here, a wide shot, including all of the girls, then you would see the cameraman in the shot. So it would totally ruin the illusion of the video. So that's why you have two or three takes just to get enough video footage to then edit it all together. So a little bit of that footage from another take has been put in, where they're obviously not concentrating on as much, they're just getting the shots. But it is something that when you are watching videos on YouTube, and I watch a hell of a lot of videos, and I've made a lot of videos myself as well, so I know the process and how much footage you have to get in order to then cut together a video that looks interesting and has a certain kind of feel to it and a certain kind of energy. So that's what would have happened during this, at least that's what I strongly suspect happened, that they've got the audio from a take and then the video section of another take has been put in. But thank you guys for requesting this video for me to take a look at. I've had quite a few requests for the warning, and it's always great to get them up on screen. They were due to come over to the UK and play a gig in London, but unfortunately that was just after, or it was at least planned for after COVID broke and then everything was cancelled, so that is a real shame. but hopefully they can make it to here in the UK and London at some point in the future. That would be great. And it's great to get them on the channel again. And hopefully we can get them on the channel again to have a chat in the future as well. I'll have to have a chat with Rudy, see if we can organize something. But thank you guys again for requesting this. And let me know what you guys think in the comments section below. And keep the suggestions coming. If you did enjoy this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe. And I'll see you guys at the next one.